Today is a really hot topic. Water heaters. No, it's not sexy, but water heater technology is kind of ingenious with its simplicity. A typical electric water heater has two heating elements, one near the bottom and one near the top, all housed in a very well-insulated cylinder. And as cold water is fed in near the bottom of the tank, the hot water is pushed out near the top. It's also pretty simple efficiency-wise. For each unit of electricity that's used, you get basically one unit of heat energy added to the water. However, my water heater is wearing one additional piece of technology on top, kind of like a hat. It's a heat pump. That means for every unit of electricity I'm spending, I'm getting 3 to 4 units of heat added to the water. It's way more efficient than any electric or natural gas water heater that you can get, but hybrid heat pump water heaters have some quirks and challenges. Also, my setup is a little unique. Like, what's that strange mini-me version of a water heater sitting next to it? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Surfshark, but more on that later. I keep saying heat pump all the things, and I'm not kidding. When it comes to energy efficiency, you can't beat a technology that seems to break the laws of physics. Generating more heat energy than the amount of energy that you put into the system is like a magic trick, but it's not. I've got a 50-gallon Rheem Proterra hybrid water heater here, and I'll be sharing my thoughts on this specific model as we go, but this is more about just using a heat pump water heater in general. Brand doesn't matter, but I'll be getting into the quirks and downsides in a bit. The biggest reason you would want a heat pump version is for exactly the reason that I mentioned already. It's mostly about the coefficient of performance, or COP. That's the ratio of energy in versus energy out, or much more simply, how much heat energy that you get for every kilowatt of electricity or natural gas therms that you put in. And just for clarity, because I'll be getting to comparing my old natural gas water heater to this new one, one therm is the energy content of about 100 cubic feet, or about 2.83 cubic meters of natural gas. The massive boost in COP is the big selling point of heat pumps in general. You'll be spending far less energy and money, in theory, to create hot water for your home. It's a very appealing sales pitch. However, this is where some of the downsides start to creep in, or at least the perception issues start to creep in. The first potential pitfall is the cost. Heat pump hybrid models are just more expensive than straight electric or natural gas models. In my old house, we had a 40-gallon natural gas model that cost about $800, not including the insulation. The Rheem I have now retails for around $1,500 plus the insulation, so there's a sizable jump in cost. However, there are rebates and incentives available in most places to help knock that cost down. Sometimes those rebates come from the state or your local utility company, so it's best to do your due diligence before you make any purchase. In my case, here in Massachusetts, there's the MassSave program, which will cover $750 of that cost. The best part about that one is that it's usually available as an instant rebate when you buy the water heater. So suddenly that $1,500 is now $750. There's also a federal tax credit of up to 30%, which is capped at $2,000 off the full installation after the local rebates have already been applied. So if the total including installation was, let's say, $2,500 here in Massachusetts, you'd end up paying about $1,225, which is the original cost of $2,500 minus $750 minus $525 for the federal incentives. The bottom line is that in some cases, it can be equal to or cheaper than a standard water heater, depending on what rebates are available in your area. But this is where a couple of common elements that I see brought up a lot come into play. But before I get into those, there's another hot technology I need to talk about that can really help your daily life, and that's today's sponsor, Surfshark. Surfshark is a fast, easy-to-use VPN full of incredible features that you can install on an unlimited number of devices with one account. Most of the time when we talk about VPNs, we're focused on giving yourself security as you travel around the world, but it can do way more than that. Since you can make it look like your IP address is coming from somewhere else in the world, it unlocks geofencing blocks on content, like streaming services. But that's not all. Even shopping services will sometimes gate prices based on your location. So you can change your location to make sure you're getting the best prices. They also have add-ons to their VPN service to unlock things like Surfshark Alert, which will let you know if your email or personal details, like passwords, have been leaked online in a data breach. So right now they're running a special deal. Use my code UNDECIDED to get up to 3 additional months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. I've been using Surfshark for years and I love it. Link in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now, the other couple of common elements that I see brought up a lot are noise and recovery time. Now, when it comes to the noise issue, your mileage will vary wildly by brand, model, and sometimes just the luck of the draw. In my case, I haven't noticed a single noise issue at all. Now, I have an insulated mechanical room that's not too far from the main living room area, and I never hear the water heater running. However, I do hear my HVAC system ramping up and down. Now, I have heard from others that they've had some noise issues with this exact model of water heater, so be aware. A friend of the channel, Paul Braren, has some great articles on his website about that issue. As for recovery time, which is a measure of how quickly it can heat cold water back up, it's also been a non-issue for me. In fact, I'd argue that this is largely a myth that heat pump water heaters have a slow recovery time. It's going to depend on how much hot water you use and what settings you have on your water heater, though. Now, for this Rheem, there are a few different modes that you can put it in. Energy Saver, Heat Pump, and High Demand. Energy Saver is the default and what I've been using. Now, on this setting, it fully utilizes the heat pump compressor for the best COP possible, but also incorporates the electric heating elements for high demand and recovery needs. It's a balanced approach. Now, the other two modes are what you'd expect. Heat Pump is full-on heat pump only, which can affect the recovery time and can even increase the energy consumption, at least according to Rheem. High Demand mode puts more emphasis on the electric elements and also increases energy consumption. And I'll be getting into what I'm actually seeing in just a minute though. The final potential pitfall of a heat pump water heater is space. And I mean physical space. Because they have an air source heat pump strapped to the top, like a hat, they need a certain air volume in the room that they occupy. The way the heat pump works is that it passes the room's air through a heat exchanger to extract that heat into a working fluid. That fluid is then sent through a compressor and turned into vapor, which circulates through the pipes, snaking around the water heater, making hot water. As the heat is extracted back out of the working fluid, it cools off, turning back into a liquid, and it's ready to repeat the cycle all over again. Now, the side effect is that the air that's getting ejected from the heat exchanger is cool and dry. If the room's volume is too small, the heat pump will lose efficiency as all the usable heat is extracted from the room's air. Now, this is very noticeable in my setup. My mechanical room is technically too small. You need about 700 cubic feet, but my mechanical room is only about 600 cubic feet. And that doesn't account for all the equipment that's inside taking up space. It's probably closer to 450 or 500 cubic feet. When we first moved into the house, the mechanical room felt like a meat locker when you'd open the door. In other words, it was really cold. There are ways that you can vent the water heater to alleviate this issue, but we opted to not do that, at least not yet. And the reason? That little mini-me tank sitting next to the Rheem is why. Now, I have my water heater tied into my geothermal HVAC system that's heating and cooling my entire house. The excess heat from that system's compressor is captured into water that sits in that tank waiting to be used by the Rheem water heater. That means our Rheem isn't refilling itself with cold water straight from the outside. It's refilling with water that's probably already over 110 degrees Fahrenheit. I really want to wire a sensor into that holding tank to track the water temp, but I haven't gotten around to it just yet. Anyway, the end result is that my water heater doesn't have to work as hard to get my water up to temp. Now, we didn't get the geothermal D superheater hooked up and working until we've been living here for almost 2 months. And after we did, I noticed that the mechanical room isn't meat locker cold anymore, but it's still cool, which is cool. And that leads me right into the performance that I've been seeing, so strap on your nerd hard hat because I'm about to drop some numbers and charts right on your head. At this point, I still don't have a ton of data, but enough to start getting a sense of where this is going. Since we didn't move until August, I'll be looking at September through January and comparing this to the same months last year with our old natural gas water heater. If you're curious, I had an Aquanta smart device installed on my water heater that tracked exactly how much gas we were using. Now for this first chart, it's the amount of gas versus the amount of electricity. You'll notice that there's a noticeable jump in October for both gas and electric, because that's when the cold weather really kicks in. December through February tend to be the highest use case months, so there's another uptick noticeable for gas in December. What's interesting though, is that you can see our electricity didn't jump in December. In fact, it's slowly been declining each month since October. My hunch right now is that it's because of the geothermal holding tank, which started up in October. It counteracted the typical increase. Operational costs are another story though. If you look at this chart, you'll notice that gas and electricity are basically a wash in September and December, but electricity is dramatically higher in October and November. The reason? Gas and electricity prices in my area. Electricity in Massachusetts is very high. In fact, we boast some of the highest in the country. We're paying around 30 cents per kilowatt hour versus gas, which is coming in around $2.18 per therm, at least at the time we were using it last year. The cost benefit is kind of a mixed bag in my area. Massachusetts electricity and gas prices mean that this cost me about 22% more for a hybrid heat pump water heater based on the limited data that I have. I have a hunch that this will change over the coming months because we're still experimenting to find the best settings for us. We may still try venting the water heater so it has more air to draw from, which would also help it out. However, if you look at the national average cost of electricity, which is 17 cents per kilowatt hour, and gas, which is $1.66 per therm, and apply it to my usage, it's a completely different story. Electricity wins hands down across the board. Nationally, it would cost you almost 21% less to go with an electric heat pump water heater. Again, this is based only on a few months of my personal data, which is going to be a little bit skewed here. I also have solar on my house, which is currently trending towards a goal of net zero energy from the grid over the course of a year. Now, if that plays out like I hope it does, the actual cost of electricity to generate my hot water will be zero, which isn't possible with natural gas. So is it worth it to go with a heat pump water heater? Yes, in the vast majority of cases, it's absolutely the best option out there. However, as you can see from my current data, it's not completely cut and dry depending on what your electricity and natural gas prices are. If you're already using a standard electric water heater, it's a no-brainer to go heat pump. Again, upfront costs really aren't that different right now with all the rebates available from utilities, state, and federal rebates. In some cases, it can be cheaper to install a heat pump water heater, and then you get the long-term benefits after that. How's it shake out for you? If you have a heat pump water heater, what's your experience been? Let everyone know down in the comments. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to be Determined, where we'll be discussing some of your feedback. And a special thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every single video and help to make these possible. I'll see you in the next one.